Hey folks, this is Shock, and we're going to get on the motorcycle here. We're riding a Suzuki Katana 600. We're going to go over here on the freeway, and this is a continuing video in our ongoing series titled, How to Debate an Atheist and Defeat Them Every Single Time. And what better way to do it than on a motorcycle on the mean, unforgiving freeways of California? I have a Kodak V as in Victor 570 camera. You can find them on eBay. They're a really good camera. I'm going to show you how the camera looks in the mirror here in a moment, but check this out. Look at the inside of my visor, how it's got Velcro. And then there's Velcro on the front strips of the camera. Check this out. So then I put the camera right in front of my mouth inside the camera to shield it from wind noise. And plus I'm hands-free. So now we're going to get on the motorcycle. We're going to start it up. And let's get on the freeway, and I'm going to go through some things with you today. I think you're really going to enjoy this. I even have Velcro for the tag because that key tag flies around a lot. Now, let it warm up just for a few moments, and here's what we're going to be going through today. I'm going to be showing you some things that you could bring up in debate with your sweet, cuddly, huggable atheist friends. Bless their sweet little primate hearts. We're going to talk about evolution. I'm going to show you how evolution actually proves that atheism is not true. We're going to talk to you about some of the things in evolution that haven't been proven. So when an atheist brings up evolution, they're really just like a neutered dog. It doesn't give them any power for their atheism. I'm going to talk to you about that. We're going to talk to you about a bunch of other things, the teleological argument, the argument from objective moral values. We're going to talk to you about why do atheists always bash God, but they never bash Satan? We're going to talk to you about a lot of things, some funny things. Go right below this video, go to shockonl.net, and you can listen to me in debate as I use these techniques and we decimate atheists every single time. Do you know the Atheist Experience Show has failed to provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct, along with all the top 20 atheists of this, I'm just looking here, all these cars keep going through the light, and I realize, see that cop, or funeral cop right there? There's a funeral here, so let's get ready. Let's give the D&D exhaust from our good friends at Fort Worth, Texas a few revs. And we're off. Here we go. I'm on a schedule right now, so I really have to go. Yeah, see, it's really like a giant funeral, but no one has the funeral stickers. You know how they usually have it on the windshield? You know, I wonder what people are going to say at Richard Dawkins' funeral. I mean, you can't really say anything. I mean, can I tell you what I would say at Richard Dawkins' funeral? I would go up to the mic and I would tap it. Is this on? And then you'd hear the feedback. And everyone would be listening. You could hear a pin drop. And I would actually take the mic out of the microphone and I'd walk up to the edge of the little podium there. And I would say, you know, guys, let's be honest. This Richard Dawkins guy was a complete nut. Hold on a second. Let's hope this guy doesn't go. All right, he didn't go. And then I would say, why would we want to go to hell like he did? Now, I got to tell you something that Richard Dawkins is afraid of. He admitted it. You know who Francis Collins is? Look up Francis Collins. And he's a brilliant individual. And Francis Collins is very much into science. And Francis Collins spilled the beans on a conversation that Richard Dawkins and him had. And here's what Francis Collins said Richard Dawkins confided in him. And you can look this up. It's been verified. It's also all over the internet. Francis Collins and Richard Dawkins admits it's true. Richard Dawkins said, and I'm going to go through something he's worried about here. It's on my list here. Richard Dawkins said, the most troubling argument against atheism for him is the teleological argument. He said that it is very troubling for his agnosticism, because you know Richard Dawkins has renounced atheism, and he now says that yes, God can exist, and he's no longer an atheist. He said he's an agnostic, which is saying that he's saying, well, I don't know either way. Now, he used to say he was an atheist, but ever since he got spanked in debate by John Lennox, Richard Dawkins is now front-sliding. He's not backsliding, he's front-sliding to theism. And maybe this is why atheism is now declining worldwide as a whole. You got Christopher Hitchens, unfortunately, who's most likely in hell right now. He's dead. You got Richard Dawkins leaving atheism and now saying God can exist, and he's chosen the wimpy way of agnosticism. You got, for example, you got atheists like Aaron Raw, Matt Dillahunty, and the amazingly hellbound atheist here on YouTube, admitting that God can exist, and they have no arguments against God's existence. So let's go through some ways that you can decimate atheists in debate. Let's talk about evolution. Now, if you're a Christian, you should be very pleased if an atheist brings up evolution in a debate where they're trying to prove that atheism is true and God doesn't exist, because you've just won that debate. Evolution doesn't claim that God doesn't exist. And most of evolution has not been proven. So let's go through it. When we say, hold on, this guy in the truck, semi-truck is going. When we say evolution, evolution is an accordion word. You know what accordion is? Those musical instruments where you can, you know, expand and compress and expand and compress, you know. Evolution is an accordion word, and it can mean a lot of things. Many of the things, even the evolutionists will admit, have not been proven yet. So let's go through how evolution actually proves that God exists and atheism is not true. And so I love when atheists, bless their sweet little primate hearts, bring up evolution. You should love it. You got these dodo birds, these complete imbeciles on YouTube like Thunderfoot and Aaron Raw, who are going around talking all about evolution, and that's fine. But evolution doesn't prove that God doesn't exist. It doesn't prove that atheism is true. Even if all of evolution were true, which it's not, I'm going to go through the parts that are not true and the parts that are. And the parts that are true are really just creation, as you'll see. But even if evolution were all true, it doesn't prove that atheism is true. It doesn't prove that God doesn't exist. If evolution were true, which it's not, but let's just say that it were true, hypothetically, nothing follows from that. We all know people that call themselves theistic evolutionists. So nothing really follows whether or not evolution is true or not. Now, evolution is not true. Only the creation parts of evolution, which they really should just call creation, are true. So let's go through it, okay? We're going to talk about three parts of evolution, only one of which is true, and that's the creation part of it. They just call it evolution. It's really creation. Number one,
scientists say, when evolutionists, creationists say evolution, here's what they're meaning. There's three parts to it. Number one, limited change. Change and diversification over time. Every single person that's listening to me, if you're young Earth, old Earth creationist, if you're the most brainwashed, Kool-Aid drinking, spaghetti monster worshiping atheist, everyone, 100% of the people listening to this agree that we have change and diversification in limits. We agree with that, that there's limits to it. We have different types of horses, but they're all horses. You see, this is diversification, change. We have change over time, limited change over time, but nevertheless change. So people agree with that. Has that been proven? Yes. But all that is God's creation. Even scripture says that God has created them after their own kind. Let's go to number two on the list, which has not been proven. Evolution history. Evolutionary history, the tree of life, Darwin's tree of life, which is an artistic rendition. It's not based on fossil evidence. There's no fossil evidence that proves that Darwin's tree of life is true. It's just conjecture. It's an idea in someone's mind that these species branch off and they evolve over time from different lineages and stuff. That has not been proven. Darwin's tree of life is not proven by the fossil record. There's no evidence for it. It's conjecture. So that has not been proven, so we have to take that off the table. So far, the only thing that has been proven is limited change over time, so we'll leave that on the table. But does that, the limited change over time, does that prove that atheism is true and God doesn't exist? Of course not. If anything, that's a theistic idea. Scripture talks about this. That's theism. So it's good to see our atheist friends embracing theist ideas. Now, is this guy going to get over? I'm being nice, trying to let him over, but now, we talked about change within limits. That's been proven. That's just creation. But they can call it evolution if they want. That's fine. I'm calling it creation. Number two, evolutionary history. By the way, don't try this at home, kids. Don't try to take a corner with one hand on the... Hey, look at that guy on that Harley. Let's see if we can catch up. Number two is... that has not been proven is the evolutionary history. How these species... Hold on, I hope this guy doesn't get funny. How these species branch off from one another. That hasn't been proven. Darwin's tree of life is what we're talking about. That hasn't been proven. So, I'm coming up on the sixth of the Harley dude. So that hasn't been proven either. And number three, which hasn't been proven, even Dawkins admits they can't figure it out, is the mechanisms for this change. I'm going to ask this guy, why are your handlebars so high? Man, that guy's got some high handlebars. The mechanism, peace, bro. Give me the peace sign. The mechanisms for the change. You atheists would like those handlebars. You know why? They're called ape hangers. Oh, you atheists, you give us so much opportunity for comedy. So the mechanisms for change have not been proven. Another thing, by the way, let me throw this in there that has been proven, and the scientists can't figure out a naturalistic way that it has been proven, is the a naturalistic way that it came about, I should say, is the origin of life. Oh, the guy's going the same way I'm going. They asked Richard Dawkins, well, how did all this life come about? And he said, I don't know. I'm a stupid agnostic. Why would you ask me difficult questions like that? Don't you know that I'm an agnostic based on blind faith and my presuppositional view of naturalism? Now let me get back to worshipping the spaghetti monster. Oh, the guy pulled that guy over there. Alright, I want this Harley guy to start going fast and around the corners and we'll follow him. So, also the origin of life, the scientists cannot prove that it was a naturalistic origin. And this guy in the Harley's going too slow. Let's give him, see if we can hide him on here. Alright, so we've covered evolution. Is evolution compatible with God's existence? Of course it is! You atheists, bless your sweet little primate hearts, you atheists that grasp at these straws and try to make it that evolution proves that God doesn't exist, you guys are idiots. Obviously, the only thing that has been proven in evolution is change within limits, and the other three things I talked about, the origin of life, which atheism has not been able, science has not been able to prove that it's a naturalistic origin. What else? The mechanisms, they haven't been able to go ahead and say that that's naturalistic. And then, what else do we got besides? Oh, and then Darwin's tree of life has not been proven. That hasn't been proven either. So evolution, even if it was true, even if all those other things were true that haven't been proven, and see that guy's shoes? I've been thinking of getting something like that. Because mine, I got laces on them. I think his are buckled. You don't want laces with a, you don't want laces in a motorcycle. Anyways, alright, what's next on the list? So by the way, let's go to Richard Dawkins' fear. Richard Dawkins admits that the teleological argument is very difficult to overcome as an atheist. The teleological argument is something that shocked scientists. Scientists discovered that this universe that we live in had to be fine-tuned for the existence of life. There's about 40 life-permitting constants. And if, imagine it like this. You have these constants, which are, for example, let's say the rate of the expansion of the universe. You have constants like, the weak force. You have constants, the nuclear weak force. You have constants like that help create, that help fine-tune and create the stars when God created them. And you know, without stars, planets could not exist. So there's not just one or two of these fine-tuned constants. In other words, these life permitting constants, if they weren't there, we wouldn't be here. We're literally living on a razor's edge. It's like this. Imagine that God is sitting at a computer and there's like 40 of these dials in front of him. And these dials adjust the fine tuning of the universe and its mathematical equation. And this dude here on the left and I, we sneak in there when God leaves the room. And we turn one of the dials, just one of them, just a hair's breadth. We could destroy life. We could destroy life on this planet. That's how fine-tuned this universe is when God created it for our survival here. Now, we don't see these constants anywhere else in the universe. It's focused like a laser beam right here on Earth. Why is Richard Dawkins worried about that? Well, he should be worried. This is empirical proof and evidence of design. Go through this with me, folks. And it's getting kind of windy here, so I'm going to have to start yelling. There's only three possible explanations for this remarkable, godly fine-tuning. Number one, dumb luck and chance. Chance did it. But chance can't create things. We all know that. If I have a basketball, and I'm throwing the basketball through the hoop, and I make it through the ball, I make the ball through the net 50 times, could we say chance did that? No! Chance didn't lift up the basketball. Chance didn't throw the basketball into the hoop. Chance didn't aim it. I did it. Basically, the ball went through the hoop because an intelligent designer, or of me, somewhat intelligent, I threw the ball through the hoop. Chance has nothing to do with causation. Chance doesn't have power to do it. Chance is the mathematical equation we use to show how many times I, an intelligent agent, were able to throw the ball through the hoop. But chance doesn't have causation. You see? So it can't be due to dumb luck and chance. The atheist, and there's an awesome looking Porsche here we're coming up with. The atheist would have to convince the rational world, and this is why Dawkins is afraid of this, because he's afraid that the rational world just doesn't believe in his irrationality. Dawkins is a nut. Dawkins would have to convince us that not one of these life-permitting constants was fine-tuned by dumb luck and chance. Not 10, not 20, but over 30 of these life-permitting constants were fine-tuned by dumb luck and chance, and we know that that is just not possible. We have to take dumb luck and chance off the table. Chance doesn't have causation. Well, what if there was something in natural law that caused the life-permitting constants to be that way? Well, scientists have looked and looked, and they can find nothing. There is no physical reason for these constants to be this way. But if you're not bigoted, and you're not prejudiced towards God, like atheists and agnostics, like agnostic Richard Dawkins is, you would admit that design is the more plausible, listen to me, atheist, rational conclusion. But if you're a bigot, towards God and prejudiced, no, you're going to grasp at straws, aren't you? You're going to go against where the evidence goes. You know why, atheist? Because that's what you're good at. You're good at denying evidence. So the teleological argument is detrimental to atheists. It destroys their atheism. You can decimate an atheist in debate. We've debated and defeated 76 atheists in a row using these arguments. Go right here below to shotgunout.net and you can listen how atheists suck in debate. They literally suck at debate. Alright, let's go through another argument that I use. I'll ask atheists, what proof or evidence do you have that would show atheism is accurate and correct? Now, there's a reason why I ask this, and the atheists are just too stupid to get it. They fall into my trap every single time. All these atheists are so stupid. Now, in defense for these people, I do love these people, I respect them, but I don't respect their stupid worldview. I don't respect their stupidity of buying into the crapola of atheism. But these atheists get stupid when they buy into atheism. You can see it. You can see them getting stupid. Pretty soon they'll be putting bananas in places that don't belong. Pretty soon you'll have men dressing up as women. That's what atheism gets them to do. Because we know most atheists are homosexual. We know that, right? It's been proven scientifically that most atheists are homosexuals. They're a little bit light in the loafers. But it's a free country. atheists choose to be homosexual, but I just think atheism's pretty gay. It's pretty gay. And so let's get back to this question. What proof and evidence do you have that atheism is actually correct? You know, Matt Dillahunty was asked that question. Matt Dillahunty has been known to dress up as a woman. I'll put some videos here below. You can see Matt dress up as a woman. But you know, Matt Dillahunty was unable to provide any proof and evidence that atheism is accurate. Correct. Do you know Aaron Raw failed the question? Aaron Raw failed the question. I don't expect him to know what proof and evidence atheism can provide to prove that atheism is accurate. Because Aaron Raw and Matilda Dillahunty, Matt Dillahunty, because he dresses up in dresses, as you'll see below this video, they're atheists based on faith. Based on faith. But as I've been watching their videos, Aaron Raw and Matt Dillahunty now say they're agnostics. So they're very confused individuals. But atheism does this to you, folks. But we asked Aaron Raw, Matt Dillahunty, Zom gets Chris, the amazing atheist, or I call him the amazingly hellbound atheist, Cult of Dusty. Every single atheist on YouTube, like the top 50 of them, we've asked them, what proof and evidence can you give that proves atheism is accurate and correct? And like idiots, they fell into the trap. You want to hear how they answered it? They said atheism is the lack of belief in God. Now, this just shows you how stupid atheists are. That's the worst thing you can say. Because what you just said is that your atheism is faith-based. You don't have any arguments against God's existence. It's just a faith-based worldview that you have. It's faithism. Let me give you an example. Suppose a Muslim said they lack belief in atheism, therefore Islam is true. But that's what atheists are saying. It doesn't make sense. I would never use the argument that I lack belief in something, therefore something is true. What is it, Porsche Day today? See, the Hindu can say, I lack belief in atheism. I don't believe atheism is true, therefore Hinduism is true. They can use the same argument atheists use. So, atheists, you've got to use arguments that are less... Let me tap my finger to my formerly Bible-speaking mouth. What's the word I'm looking for? Atheists, you got to use arguments that are less gay. Because that argument that you lack belief in God, therefore atheism is true, is pretty gay. Guys, it's gayer than that TV show Glee. It's pretty gay. But if there's one thing atheists are great at, it's gayness. Well, here's the problem. If you go into a debate, you'll hear atheists with their gay arguments. Click right below this video, go to shotgunnow.net, and go to our Debates and Debates 2 area. And you'll see Matt Dillahunty lose in debate. You'll see Aaron Raw lose and fail miserably in debate. You'll see the amazing atheist fail in debate. Matter of fact, check this out. Look right below this video, and you'll see the number one most subscribed to atheist on YouTube admitting that he cannot prove that atheism is accurate and correct. Folks, it's faithism. It's faithism. Why can't atheists prove that atheism is accurate and correct? Because it's not accurate and correct. So I want to challenge the atheist out there, give me some arguments showing some proof and evidence that atheism is true. Because for 2 years, atheists, I've been asking you this, and you guys have failed miserably. But we shouldn't be surprised. To be an atheist, you've got to be a failure in life. atheism is failure. Oh, that reminds me.
Hold on, I got...
That reminds me, I gotta tell you something. Here's a huge nuclear bomb that you can drop on atheism in debate. Ask an atheist if they believe that the universe is gonna die eventually. And they're gonna say, yeah. Well, what that means then is that all humanity is going to die, and everything that atheists said they were doing for the good of humanity was in vain, wasn't it? Because in the end, on the atheist worldview, not the Christian worldview, but on the atheist worldview, everyone dies. Humanity dies. That's the end result of atheism. Listen, not on my worldview, on the atheist worldview. That's pretty sad, folks. What that means is when these atheists say all this crap about, well, we're trying to help humanity and we're trying to do this and that and we're going to help the world. You know how the atheists try to act like they're a bunch of do-gooders? Well, when an atheist says they're going to help humanity and all that, all you got to do is say, no, you're not. Because on your worldview, your atheism ends in death. Stinking, rotting, pathetic, purposeless death. See, think about it. If an atheist says, look, I'm building this house, and I'm building this house because we're going to help humanity and everything, but you know that in the end the house is going to collapse on everybody and kill them, why would you build that house? Why would you even take the time to promote your worldview of atheism? Atheists are like Nazis walking goose step to death. Now, on the Christian worldview, we believe that God does step in and save humanity. We believe Jesus Christ returns and takes back what is his. We believe in the eternal life. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. I wouldn't tell you if it wasn't true. He talked about eternal life. He said that you're going to have life. He came to bring us life and life more abundantly. So on the Christian worldview, look at my right hand. On the Christian worldview, it ends in life. But on the atheist worldview, and this is what they admit themselves, this is their argument, not mine. On the Christian worldview, it ends in death. On the Christian worldview, it ends in life. On the atheist worldview, it ends in death. So I think that these atheists are really taking their march to death too seriously. You guys are all marching to death on your argument. Just don't bother us with it. Be a sweet little atheist Nazi. Keep goose-stepping on your way to death. But as for this ex-atheist Christian, I'm choosing life. God bless you guys. Thanks for watching. And remember, don't be an atheist. Don't be stupid. Be a Christian. Be wise.
Yeah, we all can hear you. Okay? He's doing the stall tactic. So here's the question again. He's doing the old stall tactic. Boy, I know how these guys work. The question is what proof and evidence can you provide that atheism is accurate and correct without evading? This is like the fifth time we've asked him. Go ahead, Epic.
And this is the fifth time I've answered. I've answered it in chat many times, and I've answered it to you many times. Not only have other people answered it to you, and fact is, atheism just isn't a claim. I'm not going to buy into your stuff. Atheism it's just a dumb question. It's not a real question. It just does not make sense as a question.
Ladies and gentlemen, Epic Fail just cowered to the question. You guys saw it. Notice, Princess is saying fail. We got a bunch of LOLs. Epic, that was really bad. That was really bad, Epic. So I wanted you guys to notice, we went through the debate. I went through 11 arguments. He didn't bring up any arguments of why we should believe God doesn't exist. And then when we asked, what proof and evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct, He ran from the question. Epic, would you do me a favor? Would you thank the Atheist Experience Show for turning you atheists into cowards? Would you do that? Now, Pete's in the room, and he says, that was an epic fail. How ironic, because I'm not making this up. This is a real atheist. He named himself Epic Fail. Yes, Epic Fail, you have got to thank the Atheist Experience Show. They're turning out a bunch of cowards. I think you guys have the spine like your god, the spaghetti monster. Uber, hey, Uber. I would like, since he ran from the question, I would like you guys to talk about why an atheist, when they say that God doesn't exist, and then we want them to give arguments, unless you're still in the, you're in the room where you can't talk, Uber, why is it that atheists don't want to give arguments? Why is that? It seems like they want to say that God doesn't exist, but then when we ask them what proof and evidence... Oh, by the way, I have to tell you guys something since I'm recording this. I want to go through a list of people that have failed that question. You got the Atheist Experience Show, Atheist of Florida. You got our friend Epic Fail here. Epic Fail, you got to really thank the Atheist Experience Show. They're turning out a bunch of wimps. We got, we love you, brother, and because this is going to help a lot of people on YouTube when they say, God, Epic Fail ran from the question. Now, if someone asks me what proof and evidence do you have that Christianity is accurate and correct, you guys can play back the audio. At least we gave arguments, you know. Epic Fail, do you, oh yeah, Steve likes to curse, that's right. Princess Praise is giving me, yeah, we debated Steve likes to curse, and he was not able to provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. Let me tell you another person, the amazing atheist. You know the amazing atheist, if you guys look for a video called Proof Atheism is Madness, I will give him credit. He actually said he cannot prove that atheism is accurate and correct. He actually said that. So, and then we asked Thunderfoot that, and he just ran from the question. We asked Aaron Raw that, and Aaron Raw failed the question. So it's a good question, guys. I think we should ask that more often. Yeah, Pete says, at least the amazing atheist was honest. Yeah, it really is. You know what I'm going to do, Epic Fail? I'm going to send this video to the Atheist Experience Show and show them that they're not equipping you guys for debate. They're really not. Can I give you some advice, Epic, when you go to debate people? Here's a good idea. Have some arguments.
Answering the question with the question, which atheists always tend to do, when I ask the question, here's the question. Notice I just said it. He goes, "Do we?" So here's the question: what proof or evidence can you guys provide that atheism is accurate and correct? And let's see if you can do it without asking a question with the question. And then I'll tell you how you did.
That's a fair condition, I think. I think so.
Because there was no proof or evidence when I looked for it. That's why I left the humanist religion of atheism. But go ahead. I'll listen.
All right. Thank you very much. Well, since I'm going first, atheism accurate and correct? Well,
what proof
atheism
no,
is accurate and correct?
What proof or evidence?
The evidence, first we have to make sure we understand what atheism is, because you keep talking about the humanist religion of atheism, and I think you don't know what you're talking about. You say you were an atheist. You seem to have a very
peculiar view.
You want me to answer? Go ahead and let me
go ahead. What proof or evidence?
Give me a chance to answer first. We have to make sure we're talking about the same thing, Rich, or otherwise we're only going to be talking past one another.
Whatever way you want to define it, all I'm saying is what proof or evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct.
Fair enough.
It's a very simple question. Try not to him and haw and avoid the question. Just simply answer it. You should have all kinds of proof and evidence. But
well,
I've been on about a minute, and I haven't heard
anything.
If
you want me to answer, I will do so. Are you
go
ready?
Ahead. I'm ready. I'm on the edge of my chair. You'll be the first atheist ever to answer it.
Don't fall off. Very well. We won't touch on your definition. I'll give you my definition.
No, any
definition.
Atheism's madness. So who cares what the definition is? It's madness. But go ahead and go for it. I'll listen to see what
I really appreciate your listening. So, atheism is exactly no more, no less than not having a belief in God. The evidence that atheism is correct for me is that I, through introspection, I know for a fact that I do not have any belief in a God. Therefore, I'm an atheist. Atheism is a description.
Where's your
just
proof
like,
where's the proof
my
of evidence?
Proof that I'm an atheist? You
where's
want
your proof of
you
evidence?
You want to prove that
where's
I'm
your proof
an
of evidence? That you're avoiding the question. See, typical atheist with the spine of spaghetti, what proof or evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct? I ask
the problem, Rich, is that atheism, we're atheists because of the lack of evidence for a God.
So there's lack of evidence for atheism? So what proof or evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct?
Okay, please, he's talking enough already.
Third time.
Rich, I have answered your question because you keep interrupting me.
Where's the proof? You didn't specify any proof. You failed miserably on live radio to provide any proof or evidence that atheism is accurate and correct.
No, this does remind me of last night a little bit. Let's try this without you interrupting. Will you allow me to complete a sentence?
As long as the next words out of your sweet, lovable atheist mouth is proof and evidence, we, the world, if we're going to risk denying Jesus Christ and we're going to have to believe in some other type of proof or evidence, you guys are going to have to supply more proof and evidence than Jesus Christ supplied. And what is so good about atheism? Where's the proof and evidence of atheism that would allow a rational person like me, an ex-atheist, who got two things, I got a brain and I read the Bible, a heart, and I humbled myself and I confessed I'm a sinner. So I'm
Thank
not
you.
Hearing any proof or evidence that atheism is accurate. And
I know you're not hearing. You're not taking a pause to breathe.
Go ahead.
Now that you've answered, just try not to answer. Rich, you said define atheism as I
No, I did not say define atheism. See, you're lying. Play back the audio. I said, what proof or evidence do you have? Don't lie.
We have this recorded.
How unfair.
You can listen to it later and hear what you said.
Yeah, play it back. Atheism. I never said define atheism. I said, what proof or evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct? And I'm going to be really quiet,
Rich,
and I'm going to listen to the proof and evidence. Go
okay.
for it.
Atheism is lack of belief in a God. When I say that atheism is correct, I mean that I don't have any belief in God. Do you understand that so far? Yes or no only, please.
I understand you haven't supplied any proof
Thank
or evidence.
You.
Yes, I understand you haven't supplied any proof
give
or
me
evidence.
A,
yes,
give me
I
a
understand
chance.
You haven't supplied proof or evidence. So
good
where
good
is it, though?
Okay. The evidence
someone else
that
on the line that could at least answer the question.
Rich, first of all, the evidence that I don't believe in God is my say-so. I'm saying I don't believe in God because I know that for a fact. The same way if you ask someone, what's your favorite ice
How
cream?
How do you know
they,
it for a
they
fact?
They say it's vanilla.
Where's your proof?
What is your proof that your favorite ice cream is vanilla? Can you
Where's
prove
your
that?
Proof
you
for
have
a fact?
Evidence for
it? Where's
Rich,
your proof?
Your time.
Listen. We want proof and evidence.
I can
you have failed miserably. Listen, my sweet lovely atheist. This is why I left the madness of atheism. It's based on faith. 100% faith.
This man doesn't even understand
what
atheism is.
But you guys seem like pretty upset now. We have shaken the foundation of atheism. Now that the whole world and everyone on your show knows there is no proof or evidence for atheism.
I can say the same thing for Christian.
Now we're going to give Frank an opportunity to speak. So, Rich, zip it.
It's just a matter of laughing.
Am I going to have a chance to talk after Frankie boy here?
Just cut him off. We're going to let Frank talk.
Running from the debate.
No. You're
advised. Am I going to have a chance to talk after Frank?
He's on the show. Just
sure.
You called in to ask us what we think.
Just mute him. You can mute
no,
him.
No, I asked what proof for evidence. Proof
so
and evidence.
Stand by. Go ahead, Frank.
We have come to our conclusion that there is no God because of the lack of evidence. You know, extraordinary claims like they got in the Bible require extraordinary explanations. And we haven't seen hardly any explanations at all that aren't just drawn from fables. So we have come to the conclusion that there is no God, and everything that happens to man is either accomplished by man or is destroyed by man. There is no God there to guide it.
That was a shock of God on a radio show, and he completely destroyed the atheist on the radio show. What I found really interesting there is I've come up against this for 2 years, this definition of atheism. And what you don't get from atheists is actual evidence for their atheism. And they use their definition to run away from the fact that they need to provide evidence and reasons for their beliefs. And they don't do that. They're very good at attacking you, but they don't provide evidence and reason. And I think that clip by Shock of God absolutely exposes modern atheism. I think it's a brilliant clip. It's hilarious how he just completely destroyed those atheists. And I think the problem with you atheists out there is you hang on to this definition, and in the end of the day we ask that question: where is your accurate proof and evidence for atheism? Don't ask a question. Don't start giving us definitions. We don't care about your definition. What we care about is whether you've got some proof and accurate information and evidence to prove that your atheism is correct. And I have found we've had some famous atheists make comments on this channel. We have some famous atheists make comments on Zwemer 100. But what we've never had from any atheist is any evidence from the atheist community that is accurate and that provides proof that atheism is correct in its assertions. So why is that atheist? Why will you not provide the evidence? Why will you not provide the argumentation and the evidence to show that your beliefs are accurate and correct? What the atheists will do, they'll ask you questions, they'll attack your faith, they'll criticize you, but they won't stand and provide evidence themselves. You know, who came up with this definition of atheism? Where did it come from? No atheist has been able to tell me that yet. And why is it the best definition above other definitions? What arguments do you have to prove that your definition of atheism is a better definition than other definitions of atheism? But even when you get to your definition, why, at the end of the day, don't you just give us some proof and evidence that atheism is correct? I say, Shock of God completely and utterly destroyed you atheists. And I can see why you get angry with him, because he's absolutely demolished you. Alright. So thanks, Shock of God. Thanks for doing that and providing us with some total amazing clip that shows that atheism is completely rubbish and that we need to have something that we can hold on to. And his name is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who died and rose again. Thank you for listening, and God bless you.
What we mean by science. For me at least, and I think for most people, science and evidence are kind of inextricably linked to one another. So I'm going to talk about evidence. And in the same way as I chose a very simple idea of an axiom in order to describe what I mean by that, I'm going to have a very simple example of the use of evidence. And the example I'm going to use, if you'll forgive me, are our chairman's boxers, by which I don't mean his dogs or his chain of prize fighters, but his boxer shorts. And I'm going to make, to begin with, an assumption that our chairman is wearing Union Jack boxer shorts. But it's not quite just an assumption, because this could be supported by evidence. I'm not going to ask him to reveal what kind of, he may not even have boxer shorts on at all. I'm not going to ask him what kind of boxer shorts he has on. But clearly that assumption is testable by evidence. In other words, it's not really an assertion at all, it's a hypothesis. It's a very trivial hypothesis, trivial in the sense that we could settle the matter once and for all by asking to see his boxer shorts. I'm not going to do so. But we could do, we could refute at a stroke my hypothesis, or we could confirm it, and that would be the end of the matter. But scientifically, this is trivial and not very useful to us, and really very, as you might imagine, in all sorts of ways, atypical of science in general. But it's atypical in a particularly important way that I want to explain now. And I'll replace my first hypothesis with a more scientifically meaningful one. My more scientifically meaningful hypothesis is that our chairman always wears Union Jack boxer shorts. Now, we could make a start this evening in testing that hypothesis. If we saw his boxer shorts and they were not Union Jack boxer shorts, that hypothesis would be refuted at a stroke. If he was, that could do no more than increase my confidence somewhat that my hypothesis is correct.
You'll remember that in my first speech, I said I would defend two basic contentions in tonight's debate. First, that there's no good reason to think that belief in God is false, which Professor Bagan must show if he's to defend the view that it is an illusion or delusion. Unfortunately, we've yet to hear any arguments tonight to think that that belief is false, and so far we've not heard any grounds for thinking that belief in God is delusory. Now, what about my arguments to show that belief in God is not delusory, but is in fact a true belief? Here, I am surprised by how conciliatory Dr. Bagan is toward my arguments. Take the first one, based on the origin of the universe. He accepts the first premise, he accepts the second premise. Therefore, it follows with logical necessity that the universe has a cause of its existence. Now, I wonder what Professor Bagan thinks that cause is. If those two premises are true, there must be a transcendent cause beyond space and time, beyond the universe, which brought the universe into being. Who or what is this? Well, I argued that it must be, and I quote from my opening speech, a being which is timeless, spaceless, uncaused, immaterial, and having unfathomable power. All of those follow from the properties of being beyond time and space. Moreover, I argued it had to be personal as well, because the only thing that fits those descriptions are either abstract objects or a mind, and abstract objects don't stand in causal relations. And I submit to you that given my experience of God as a living reality in my life, in the absence of some sort of defeater, like some arguments for atheism, which haven't been offered yet in the debate tonight, I see no reason to think that my experience is delusory, and therefore I'm perfectly within my rational rights to believe that God exists on the basis of my personal experience of God. So there is an argument here. The argument is that we can rationally accept belief in God as a properly basic belief grounded in one's experience of God in the absence of any defeater of that belief. So in summary then, it seems to me that Dr. Bagan's epistemological evidentialism is naive, it is overly restrictive, and in the end self-refuting. And in any case, I met his challenge by giving good evidence for God's existence. Five reasons to think that God exists. On the other side of the ledger, we've yet to hear any evidence to think that God does not exist. And therefore, I think we have good grounds for thinking that belief in God is not a delusion, but quite the contrary, that God exists.
And he says that I must show that a belief in God is false. I don't know why the onus has to be on me. I thought it was on him. But let's just consider that a moment in my last half minute here. It seems to me that a belief is false if it is held in the absence of evidence. There is no evidence for this belief, therefore a belief in God is false. Thank you.
Before I look again at those two contentions that I said I'd defend tonight, let's try to say something more about these matters of epistemology. Remember, I argued that the dictionary definition of a delusion is a false belief or opinion. So Dr. Begin is offering us a revisionary definition of what a delusion is. And he's saying that something is a delusion if it is neither self-evident nor held on the basis of evidence. And in his last speech, he made the astonishing assertion that a belief is false if it is held in the absence of evidence. Well, that's patently wrong. It's easy to give counterexamples. Suppose I believe that there is a person standing right outside this door at this very moment. I have no evidence for that. Does that mean that belief is false? No, he could be there right now. In fact, when we make predictions about the future, we don't know whether they'll come true or not, but if they do come true, then those were true predictions. So it's patently wrong that a belief is false if it is asserted in the absence of evidence. But I gave two criticisms of his evidentialism. First, that it's overly restrictive. Remember my example, how it would undermine science. The special theory of relativity is based upon certain assumptions about the one-way velocity of light that cannot be scientifically proven. Another example, the Copernican principle. This underlies all of modern astronomy. It states that we occupy no special place in the universe. Without the assumption of this principle, it's possible that the distant galaxies operate according to other laws of nature, and therefore all of our data about them is wrong. You simply have to assume the Copernican principle that the same laws operate there that operate here in order for astronomy and astrophysics to even be possible. So his evidentialism would destroy science if you adopted it. Moreover, it would mean our beliefs in the external world, the reality of the past, are not justified. He says, no, these are based on evidence. Well, this is just philosophically naive. I think he needs to take a good dose of reading in skeptical thinkers like Descartes and David Hume, who will show that all of my experience would be exactly the same if I were a body in the matrix. There's nothing you can do scientifically by way of gathering experience to show that that's false. It is simply a properly basic belief that is grounded in our experience of the external world. But you can't provide evidence for it because that assumes that the evidence we gather is veridical, which is what the hypothesis denies. Moreover, I pointed out that it's self-refuting. The statement, only believe in what is self-evident or inferred by evidence, is not itself self-evident. In fact, most philosophers today disagree with it. Neither is it based on evidence. It's an arbitrary definition and a bad one at that. Now, what's the cash value of this? It means that if you're to show that God is a delusion, you've got to show the belief to be false. That's what the definition of a delusion is. It's a false belief or opinion, and we've yet to hear any evidence tonight to show that it is false.
We're going to begin. Thank you. Next question, please, for Professor Began.
Professor Began, you say that beliefs held without evidence are irrational. Would that not make your own belief that God does not exist irrational, given that you have no evidence for it?
Well, I do not believe, I do not hold the belief that God does not exist. That is an accusation that is often made against atheists. I believe that God is a delusion. I am here to defend the proposition, or to propose the proposition, that God is a delusion. A delusion to me is a belief held when there is no evidence to support that. I am not making the positive statement that God does not exist, and you should really not accuse me of saying that. To say that God is a delusion is very different from saying that God does not exist. As a scientist, I wouldn't make such a statement.
Professor Craig.
Those statements are only different if you adopt this non-standard definition of a delusion that he's offered us tonight. But according to the dictionary, a delusion is a false belief or opinion. So if the statement God exists is a delusion, that means that that is false. And if one asserts that that is false, then the questioner is quite right. This is an assertion to know something. It's a claim to knowledge, as opposed to agnosticism, which says God may or may not exist. But if you claim that God does not exist, you're making a knowledge claim, and that therefore requires warrant, particularly on evidentialism, as she rightly saw. The evidentialist would need to provide some sort of argument. And traditionally, atheists have tried to do this. The evil and suffering in the world, can God make a stone heavier than he can lift? You know all the arguments. But none of these, I think, are successful in supporting atheism, and so I don't think there are good grounds for thinking that the evidentialist atheist can bear his share of the burden of proof.
We have a couple of callers. Would you like to bring one in? Warn you, if you are calling,
I'm on.
Oh, and Dick.
But
hello.
There's another guy on too, so I don't want to talk over him. Who's the guy that said he's muted? You weren't muted, by the way.
I have no idea. Who are you, and tell us about yourself?
Oh, yeah, hi. I am an ex-atheist, and I always listen to the show. I really like the format that you guys have. And why is it that, are you British? Why is it that atheists are British?
Me? Yes, well, I was born in England. I'm from Winchester in the south of England originally, but I haven't lived in decades. And I am actually an American citizen now, and consider myself an American. So yes, a bit like the founding fathers, I'm English originally, but now, you know, I consider myself an American. Yes. Why do you consider yourself an ex-atheist?
I'll tell you why, and I think we could have fun on the show, and I think you guys, this is probably going to be the most popular show that
if it
you guys
isn't
ever
fun,
had.
We will.
And I'm actually a total big fan of your show, but let me answer your question, and here's what I would like to do. I had some questions too, but let me answer yours first, and then I would like to like hang with you guys just for a little while and kind of do a little back and forth. Tell me what you think. But
as you're not offensive, I'm sure that wouldn't be offensive at all.
Yeah, as long as I'm just kind of give me like a chance to kind of talk. Deal?
Oh, please do. But as I say, if you're offensive at all, we will cut you off. I do.
You know us Christians believe in objective moral values, so we're never offensive.
Don't know that.
Yeah.
I won't go Pol Pot, Stalin, Mao, or those other guys.
But I'm sure you can explain what you're talking about.
Okay.
Oh, sure,
hold
sure.
Let him talk, please.
Sometimes there's a delay. So I want you guys to know if we kind of cut each other off, I understand, because sometimes there's like a little delay. So let me kind of get out why I left atheism, and then also why I think atheists are having, kind of give you a different perspective, why atheists have a hard time getting people to, you know, come on board to atheism, okay? The first thing is, and I got a question for you guys, but let me kind of go through this and then I'll wait. There really is no proof or evidence that atheism is accurate or correct. I think most people, like me, they leave atheism because there's no proof and evidence. There's a lack, L-A-C-K.
Wait. I'm going to have to stop you there.
Oh, wait a minute. You said you weren't going to interrupt me.
I want to stop you there. You talk proof to atheism.
It's already happening.
And it's not... not in our, it's saying there's nothing there is not the same as saying there is something there. If you make extraordinary claims, you have to be extraordinary.
Yeah, you can answer it later, but I wasn't done yet. Go ahead, let the host talk. Go ahead, host.
And.
Sorry.
Okay.
Thank you, guys.
So,
no,
look,
I
okay, give me so that was 2 seconds.
This is kind of,
Hand, please don't interrupt him.
I will keep,
look, I can refute him all day, so can you, and we all know.
Oh, good. Good, because I know it's...
From every standpoint, you have a perspective. I'd like for him to finish his comment
quickly. We'll mix it up. I know, I know it's 2-1, and you guys are outnumbered.
No, please do.
Okay,
we're going
to
get
back to the... Let me get back to this. I'll kind of fly through it, guys, and maybe just kind of write it down, because I'll go through real quick. The number one problem I see from ex-atheists that I talk to is if you watch these debates like the Hitchens-Craig debate and Sam Harris and these debates, what atheists tend to do is just reject what the theist is saying. And I know the theists do the same thing with the atheists, but except the theists actually give some proof and evidence, some arguments for their side. And so the big reason why people leave atheism is there's a lack of proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. I know you want to get to that, so let me kind of finish up with the other three things, and the next three will go faster. And I would like to ask you guys, without evading, when you get on, without evading or chickening out, provide some proof and evidence, something that we could research that would show that atheism is accurate and correct. Okay, so that's the question there. But here's the other three things.
Well, I have an answer
also,
to that. So
have you guys noticed that atheists always bash God, but they never bash Satan? The third thing, hold on, Dan, listen to what the host said. The third thing, and I'm almost done, the third thing is, I think this is why, when you look at the studies, atheists are now the least trusted minority, like where the host and I, we live in the U.S., in the United States. They're the least trusted group, even under the homosexual community or the Muslim community. And I think the reason why is because, you know, you guys are giving mixed messages. You dedicate a whole show to bashing God, and you say all these things about God, but then you say, oh, but, yeah, he doesn't exist. Right, my atheist friends. Can you see why you're now the least trusted group in society? So let me just
say
my last
statement. Are you ready for a response?
Yeah. I'm almost ready. And then can I talk after you guys are done talking to you so I could respond?
We will come back to you for a response.
All right, fair enough. So here's the last thing I'm saying.
I do have a guest coming on the show, and we will be pausing for them because it's an important guest.
All right, good.
It's a friend of mine.
Don't forget...
Regardless of this debate, I do want to have them on. That's vital.
Oh, definitely.
This
almost
is an atheist show, and relatively, we're not really used to debating, so I don't want to make entirety of the show.
Right. No, but I appreciate being so kind and stuff, but you watch this will be like the most popular show because people... So here's the last statement, because I keep getting interrupted. The last statement is, this is the biggest objection to atheism, and then I'll listen to what you guys say, and then please give me a chance to respond, and I'll talk real fast. The biggest objection to atheism also is on the atheist worldview. Out of your own mouths, what happens, you guys are claiming you don't believe in eternal life, heaven, hell, etc., but we know that science has shown that the universe is going to die. So humanity, unless God steps in, of course, humanity, everyone dies on the atheist view. So I think you guys are taking your atheism way too seriously, because on your worldview, it ends in utter, total failure. Humanity dies, everything dies.
Not
now,
really.
That's a theistic worldview. Well, tell me how you're going to escape
the
death of the universe.
Worldview.
But go ahead. I'll listen
Please.
Now, but I want to hear the proof and evidence first. Go ahead. I'm going to write down what you say and then give me a chance to respond.
Hold
go.
On. Okay.
I have pages of notes on this, so Rachel, please do.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. So let me start with the start. And you're talking about Christopher Hitchens and base his tactics to evidence. I'm not sure what you call evidence, because there is no evidence for any God. There's no proof that there's anything that has existed, will exist, that is a divine creature. There is no proof that you have that we can break the laws of physics. So,
so the question
if you
was,
want to say
the
there's a
supernatural,
hold on,
atheism.
Then
finish.
That's
you
the way to have to break the physical laws. Now, when it comes to atheism being less trusted than even rapists, I want to say this. Of course, people who are indoctrinated to believe that everybody who isn't thinking like them, behaving like them, are going to not trust us because we don't think like them. And that ties into your proof. We, you know, atheism isn't wrong because we...
It isn't what? I didn't hear that. I'm sorry.
...reject your faith because we reject what you consider evidence. I study cellular biology, and looking at the numerous species that have existed, the adaptations, the parasitic creatures on this planet, the anomalies, the fact that we found T-Rexes with tumors, you know, the overwhelming biological evidence that no creator is up there pushing anything towards a designed anything, but everything is just chaotically living and trying
chaotic?
To exist. Absolutely.
No.
We live in chaos.
I don't want to interrupt you,
and you can't
you, so
say we
I
don't,
want you to,
because...
Yeah, I don't want to interrupt you. I want you to finish, but if I can just say something when you're done, because I had a question on what you said, but go ahead. I want to be completely silent for the whole thing.
Let Rachel finish, and then you can come back.
Yeah, no problem.
Well, you know what? People talk about free will all the damn time, and I get tired of hearing that bullshit, because you talk about free will, and free will is you're the creator of your own disaster, but God was somehow responsible for giving you this quote-unquote free will, which punishes you for everything that's not subservient to him. And then it tries to explain the chaos of this world. And when I say chaos, I mean billions of species interacting and intertwining in a way that each of us humans are conscious that 7 billion of us others exist. But we don't live our lives trying to make sure they exist happily, healthily. We go about our lives, and if you see car crashes and accidents and horrendous things that people do, we do exist in chaos because you can't predict what's going to happen to you when. And you can't predict what animal will or won't hurt you, what environment that's going to happen in, if you'll get a parasite, if you won't, if you'll get a tumor, if you won't. All of these things at play. Yes, the chaos is there. And I love it when Christians do this and they glaze over it and they look at a beautiful sunset and they go, oh, look at this majesty. This is God's creation. They don't do the same thing when they see a tsunami and it's destroyed a complete half of a country. They don't go, oh, look at this. This is the beauty of God's design. Well, the designer is pretty fucked up, okay, because he created worms that will eat your brains out, worms that will eat your bladder, worms that will live in your gut. I mean, all kinds of crazy, hideous things that you would never imagine if you were creating something to be so majestically beautiful. So I don't know what evidence you think you have for some divine creator, but he's not that divine because science could do better. And by the way, if your creator is so divine, why didn't his book entail all of the scientific knowledge we would ever need to exist on this planet? Why is he only worried with our genitalia and what we're doing with it? Because that sounds to me like an uneducated, pedantic mind that doesn't know the scope of intellect enough to talk about science, but only knows what you're doing with your genitalia. And as far as why atheists talk about God and rage about him, because we have to stoop to your level. You don't understand our level, because when we say there's no God, we're saying there's no evidence for any God. And so we have to come down
no
to
God?
Your level for you to understand how we look at your religion.
Hey, hold on. Caller, what can we call you? What is your name?
Rich.
Rich, okay. It doesn't have to be a real name. It just has to be something we can call
that
you.
That is my real name.
You talked about proof.
Oh, and by the
you
way, talked... I want to thank the host. Thanks for going through all that, because I wanted to respond to what you said, because there's one thing I think you would agree on, but let me let the gentleman talk, and then...
No, that's fine. No, please, tell us what you think. That would be very interesting.
Oh, you want... Okay. This is what I think. I didn't hear any proof and evidence that would show that atheism is accurate and correct. What you said was, your God's design is absolutely...
We don't have the obligation to provide you any proof of a negative.
You did claim that God doesn't exist.
I claim that there's no evidence.
Guys,
did you not hear this?
Guys?
I agree that there's no evidence that atheism is accurate.
So,
we can't provide you evidence of a negative.
I can rifle off six arguments for God's existence real quick, and then I want you to give me some arguments for atheism.
Well, we can repeat your argument.
Listen,
first
hold on.
Of all, is
property
by the nature of
through objective moral values.
Excuse me. We can talk
about abiogenesis also, but I haven't heard any evidence that atheism is accurate and correct.
I didn't get a chance to respond.
You told me to respond, and then when I start, you cut me off, but go ahead.
No, I just want to go back and talk about the nature of proof, right? And the nature of proof is the fact that if you assert something, then the burden of proof is on you. The burden of proof
you
is not on the
God
person that...
Is, that you made a knowledge they, claim. The host
if,
made
if
a knowledge
were,
claim God doesn't exist.
Please listen to what I'm saying. Listen to what I'm saying. The burden of proof is, if you were to tell me, for instance, that there is a pink statue of my grandmother floating 6 feet above my bed, the burden of proof is on you to prove it, not on the person that says that is not true. The burden of proof is not upon the...
But we're not talking about
that. Yes, we are talking about exactly that.
No, we're talking about God.
I'm not understanding. The burden of proof is not on the person
and we're
that
still talking about the same thing.
I haven't heard, guys, how long have I been on? I haven't heard any proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and incorrect.
Everybody, that's the question.
Rich,
let me just ask again. What proof and evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct besides your opinion?
No, what?
Give me something.
Okay, first of all,
give me something. This is why people leave atheism.
First of all, stop, or I'll put you on hold, okay?
I'm on hold. I'm waiting.
No, we're very happy. But you have to understand the nature of proof. If you assert
Hold on, Stan, let me break something down real quick, because I keep catching this, and it needs to be addressed. You keep saying that we have some burden of proof. We don't have any burden of proof on us.
Uh-huh.
You want us to provide evidence for a negative. I keep telling you that is not the case, and I make it very clear. We cannot prove there is no God, but there is no evidence to suggest your God,
you just said,
the Muslim
hold on,
God,
I missed that.
The Hindu 3,000
no,
plus any of them
what,
have
what do you
ever
say? You can't
existed.
Prove that there is no God?
And we're not going to change that to suit the fact that you want us to provide you with something. You can't even show me where
well,
your
on, guys,
God
being very respectful. Don't hang
break
up. I mean,
the laws
respectful.
Of physics. As Christopher Hitchens has said, supernatural claims require supernatural evidence. If you want to claim that there is something supernatural, then you have to prove how it can break the laws of physics to exist.
To the host, can I ask you something? Because I thought I heard you say something, and I just want to make sure I don't
misquote you. It's Rachel.
You
can call me Rachel.
All right, Rachel. Sorry, Rachel. I didn't know your name. Rachel, did you just claim that you can't prove that God doesn't exist? Did you say that statement?
I said it like every atheist will say to you who is logical and rational.
So if you can't
we
prove that God doesn't
exist,
listen to
exist,
her argument. Listen to what she actually says before you jump in.
I'm trying to listen, but you keep talking over her. Go ahead, Rachel.
Listen.
The burden of proof is on the claim. We cannot prove that God does not exist, but there is no evidence. And until such time as you provide us evidence, we abstain from belief in any divine figures until such time as there is proof. We make the logical call. We say, look, I don't believe in pink unicorns. I don't believe in teapots floating around the moon.
Oh,
I don't
doing
believe
so good,
in divine
Rachel.
Figures
you
that can break
the
laws of physics. No,
listen,
I mean, makes logical sense. You know what? Here's the problem with Christians. I'm going to put you on hold for a second if you don't stop
all right.
we're talking.
He's talking. I'm just trying to... Well, let me get over to Edgewise. But go ahead.
I have to finish the statement before you can...
All right, just don't hang up on me like most atheists get afraid and hang up, so don't get afraid and hang up on me. Go ahead.
I'm not afraid of you at all.
Oh, good.
Okay?
So don't hang up.
And it's not about fear. It's about frustration because the problem is you have this cognitive disconnect. Anytime that I say to you that there are parameters for proving a divine figure, anytime that I say to you that the burden is not on us, you don't want to hear it. What you want to hear is that there is a weakness and a flaw in atheism. But we make the logical call. All that you have is an indoctrination, which you return to, because you obviously haven't looked at the evidence. If you looked at all of the evidence that I have seen...
I left my indoctrination.
I don't care if you were an atheist for 10, 20 years. It doesn't mean that you did the work to be the atheist. And a lot of people don't. They simply get angry and they go, oh, there's no God. Or they make some snap judgment. But they never do the work to understand why it could be the point to be an atheist, why it could be valid to be an atheist. You didn't do the work, and it shows. Because the first thing
that
you do is start talking about atheism like it's a religion.
Rachel, can I say something? Rachel,
please,
you have failed miserably to provide proof and evidence that atheism is actually correct. However, you have conceded that you cannot prove that God doesn't exist. Therefore, you're not in atheism, you're in faithism. You're taking this all based on faith.
See, this is, I love this. Christians
I love
can't
it too.
Get it.
Your show is
I
great
love
for
the
theism.
Cognitive disconnect.
you right.
can't
you're
prove
right.
X, Y, or Z, so L must be
Give
true.
Give me some argument.
No,
Give me an
if
argument.
I can't
I
prove
to the one
that
you said
the
about
stars
dinosaurs.
Live in my bedroom, that doesn't
Rachel,
mean it's true because I can't
not
prove it.
How do dinosaurs prove that God doesn't exist? You
oh, heavens, heavens.
How do dinosaurs prove that God doesn't exist? Come on.
No, no.
How about
come on,
you just
digging yourself
you know
a deeper
what?
Hole,
that doesn't
my
even
dear.
Make rational sense. Where do you fit that in your logic?
That's what you said. You were bringing up dinosaurs and all this. None of that shows that God doesn't
Actually,
exist.
Actually, no. At this point, I was bringing up speciation and parasites and cancer.
You brought that up, too.
And the fact that a T-Rex had
exist?
A tumor.
Wait, let Rachel
the fact
talk.
That the same things in nature that happen to humans happen to
okay.
animals.
How does
that
prove that
all
atheism
related.
Is true?
That evolution happened, that we have overwhelming evidence of it, that there seems to be no divine direction. Humans
Rachel,
are cousins to chimpanzees.
Rachel, how
we
does
share
that prove
common
that God...
ancestor. We have evolved on bipedal, ape-like creatures.
Give him one last
You know,
word,
I could go
okay.
on and on.
Yes.
And you still
and then
won't
we
listen.
Yeah, but
yes.
Rachel, here's the thing. Don't hang up on me, guys. You said you're going to say, listen. Here's the
you're
thing.
One, so make
Rachel,
this, make this
Rachel
count,
conceded.
Dude.
Rachel conceded that she cannot prove that God does not exist. You guys should change this to the theistic show, the pink theist show. You should change it to the theist show. But, Rachel, you didn't give me any proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. None
you know,
at all. You talk about dinosaurs, tumors.
Because you can't get
it. It totally
you
is.
Don't,
this is
you know
why
what?
Atheism
just because
is
you
such
don't
a
make
small
rational system. Sense doesn't mean atheists
right.
don't.
Theists rule the world.
You know what? We make the
guys.
Rational sense. Because
theists
I don't make judgments based upon no evidence. You make all
yes,
of the judgments
did.
Based
an
upon
based
no,
on
evidence.
No evidence. You know what? Dr. Craig was
argument.
Right. Dr. Craig said... It is the atheist that believes in a
few
oh, listen,
Dr. Craig.
Guys, of which,
well,
of
there's
which
some great
there
information.
Is, oh,
all right.
Rick,
thank you very much.
Hold on, don't cut me off. The atheist believes in a view of which there is no evidence.
And what do you believe in?
I believe in things that have proof and evidence. That's why I'm
oh, yes?
atheist.
And what are
those? I don't have enough blind
yeah,
faith to be like you guys.
If you believed in things that had proof and evidence, you would believe in science.
I really believe
in
rationally you didn't give me any evidence.
Evaluating
Rachel,
your dogma.
Be honest. You admitted that you cannot provide any proof and evidence that atheism is actually
and
correct, didn't you?
What does
no,
that
you
mean besides that you want to find
did you
a
admit
flaw?
That? Did you admit it? Be honest. Everyone listening.
No,
did
we,
you
we,
admit
we,
Here's the thing, I can admit
Rachel,
it all day,
Rachel,
and it will still lead to the same...
Rachel,
okay. I'm,
did
I'm
you admit
you
that there is
because...
no proof and evidence? Oh, she's running from the debate as usual.
Oh, no, we're not running for debate, and if anything, Rich, we have a guest coming on,
And I'd like to keep you, if possible, on hold so that we can talk to our guests, but then come back and talk about this sort of debate, perhaps with our guest, if that's okay?
Well, the problem here is this. It's going to keep being circular because he wants to hear that, oh, you can't prove a God exists, so therefore it's the same theist view. You can't prove it, so therefore he must exist.
The burden of proof is not on us. The burden of proof is on the people making the claim.